Megan Long, M-E-G-A-N-L-O-N-G.
Megan, did anything, can you walk through what happened today?
So today, Judge Hill heard probable cause on this defendant, Martinez Rangel. It was similar probable cause to what was heard yesterday with Franklin Pena. However, the big difference was that we have gotten into Martinez Rangel's phone and found evidence that he was searching for ways to leave the country once his image was released to the media.
We've heard in your probable cause you talked about maybe Pena making claims about Rangel. Does that affect how the case is handled going forward? Will they always appear in the same courtroom going forward, or will they be separate?
They'll always be appearing in front of the same judge in the 232nd. They'll be appearing on different dates moving forward because we did file motions to keep them separate. But they'll stay with the same judge throughout.
It was said that Martinez has two children, 2 and 5 years old. Are they present in the United States or in Venezuela?
His defense attorney stated that they are not here in Harris County. I do not know if they're here or in Venezuela, just not in Harris County. That's all I can say.
Can you talk about prosecuting this case? Obviously, got very emotional at the end for Justin's family, but just you all been making sure that they get the justice.
Every case is difficult. In the homicide division, we always unfortunately meet people at one of the worst times of their lives. They've just lost a loved one. So it's always very emotional for us as prosecutors, because with every family you meet, you see your mother, your aunt, your cousin in every case. And so it's always very difficult. It's especially difficult when you're dealing with the loss of a 12-year-old child who had their whole life ahead of them. So this will be a very emotional case for us as prosecutors as well as the family. But we look forward to continuing to work hard on this case and getting justice for Jocelyn.
What's the expected timeline to get results to determine if the sexual assault happened?
It's our intention to expedite the testing on the buccal swabs that we took from the defendant, as well as from the SANE exam. That would be a question for the lab in terms of how soon, but we would like to get those answers as soon as possible so that we can start to get some answers for the family.
If that comes back positive, will you guys bring that to the grand jury, or would it be in public court?
We would present any facts and evidence that we have towards that to a grand jury for them to possibly indict this under a different type of capital murder for possible underlying sexual assault. So that would be presented to a grand jury. If they believe we have enough evidence to prove that and would indict under that, then it would be a part of their public indictment.
Based off generally the pressure on prosecutors with crimes specifically from illegal migrants?
I'm sorry, say that again.
You talked about the pressure on prosecutors with crime in general, but specifically crime from illegal migrants?
For me, it's just about prosecuting the case. What does the evidence tell me and moving from there? So wherever they're from, I treat every case the same. I'm about getting justice for the victims.
Based off the evidence that you all have read in court, do you presume that Jocelyn was sexually assaulted?
I never like to presume anything. I think that's a dangerous thing as a prosecutor. The most important thing to me is finding the evidence and following the evidence. So if the evidence points towards a sexual assault, then we'll proceed that way. But it's dangerous to presume anything in my line of work.
Or do you think it likely may have happened, a sexual assault may have likely have happened?
I can't say. I want to see the evidence and what we find from there.
So let me get this straight. Can see about an ID.
Sorry, there's a couple people at once. Sorry.
All right, let me get this straight.
Okay.
Has the essay kit been run yet?
That would be a question for the lab. I'm meeting with the lead detective this afternoon, and so I'll get more details on the status of that this afternoon.
I find it kind of interesting that Lieutenant Hope, in his initial discussion on the case, said that he had not ordered the SA kit run, and I'm not being from here, where I come from, the SA kit is usually one of the first things run and run by the coroner's office. Now, this body has been in the coroner's office now for more than a week. Before that, it was in a bayou. The DNA is degrading. Do you expect this to have any kind of outcome on obtaining said evidence?
I do not, no.
Do you share the judge's concern about a possible ICE deportation?
I don't know enough about the way that ICE works in terms of if someone makes a bond here being deported. I'm more concerned about making sure the bond is sufficient here in Harris County to ensure that he comes back.
Megan, you mentioned that you guys were able to get access to the defendant's cell phone, and there was evidence in there that showed that he was looking for ways to escape the country. Was there anything else that you guys noticed in the phone that was part of the evidence?
At this time, we're still going through the phone. As you can imagine from our own phones, that there's lots on there, and so it's still a process of going through that phone. We want to be careful and take our time as we go through it so that we don't miss anything. But that was one of the things that was found by a homicide detective that we thought was important for the judge to hear when considering bond.
And he got an affiliation from these people to a gang in Venezuela.
I'm sorry, say that again?
Any gang affiliation from them.
All of that is being investigated.
I want to make sure, because this is not a death penalty eligible crime as it is charged right now on federal law, you guys cannot have a hearing to hold this man without, to ask him to be held without a bail. Is that correct? You're not allowed to have that hearing.
That's correct. So the way that you mostly see people held without bond in capital murders is what's called a proof evident hearing. And one of the things I would have to prove at that hearing is that a jury would likely give death. Because this is not death penalty eligible, I can't have that hearing by law. Now, what the judge was explaining is if we change this case to a capital murder with an underlying of sexual assault or kidnapping, those cases are death penalty eligible, and then at that time we can have a proof evident hearing to hold them at no bond.
I think there's been some confusion about whether you guys don't want to have a hearing because you don't want to present evidence. That's not the case in this case.
That's not the case because I legally cannot do it because he cannot receive the death penalty as he is charged right now. But again, charges are just the start. This case is still young and the investigation is continuing every day. And as we gather more evidence, the charges could change.
The witness that was with the two suspects at El Hoz Locos.
I'm sorry, I'm hearing two people.
So the witness that was with the two suspects at El Hoz Locos, did he provide any more information as to maybe conversations, drinks that were shared before those moments?
Nothing that I have found at this time that is relevant to the case at hand. But again, we talk to witnesses again and again, and sometimes they might share more as we speak to them, but at this time, nothing that would be of note for a probable cause.
And the kidnapping would be from the 7-Eleven to the bridge?
The kidnapping would be with the tying up under the bridge, yes.
What is your relationship with two suspects?
It's our understanding that they met each other on their way up here to the United States and then became reconnected once they got here.
We've been seeing kind of across the country Venezuelan gang migrants. Do they have any gang affiliations back in Venezuela?
That's being investigated at this point. So at this time, I can't make any affirmative statements as to whether they are, but that is being looked into.
Tanya had been here for about a month, I think you said yesterday. Was Rangel Martinez here longer?
He got here in March of this year, so a little bit longer.
When you say here, United States?
The United States. He crossed the border in March of this year.
Megan, what is the challenge right now in this case for you as a prosecutor? What is the challenge?
The challenge would just be, I think, gathering all of the evidence. This case has called upon a lot of different agencies. All different agencies without Harris County have come together to try to get justice for Jocelyn. And so gathering all that together and parsing through it and trying to put the pieces together will probably be the most difficult part in putting the case together. But, I mean, at the end of the day, we as prosecutors, we do this because we love what we do, and we want to get justice for these victims. So the long hours in the end are worth it. So.
And can you just lay out the charges real quick for all of us?
Yes, so they're charged with capital murder for an individual 10 to 15. And so that's the age range. Because she's a 12-year-old girl, she falls within that range. And that's the only charge they're facing at this time.
How do you feel that both of them received a 10-year?
I'm very pleased that the judge set bonds in that amount. I think it's sufficient to ensure the safety of the community and that they will return if they were to make that bond.
Are they having separate trials and why?
They would. So they would have separate trials eventually. That's just how it's done. You can sometimes bring them together, but that's more of a defense thing than the state. But we want each of them to have their own day in court and present the case against them.
Okay, y'all good?
We couldn't even, I wasn't able to hear all of them. It wasn't top of her.
Pena stated that this defendant, Martinez Rangel, was on top of her. But that's coming from the co-defendant. So once we receive the physical evidence and start looking into that more, we hope to have a clearer picture of exactly what happened under the bridge.
Pena seems to have, I don't want to say confessed, but really outlined the allegations against Martinez Rangel. When and if he goes to trial, would there be any deals to lessen his sentence if he is outlining, further outlining the crime?
It's way too early to say if we would do something like that, but that's always a possibility. But as I stand here today, I think they both need to have their trials and be held responsible without any deals like that.
And just to clarify, Martinez, he admitted to tying her arms and legs, and he had bite marks and scratches on his arms and legs?
That's correct. At his arrest, he had a bite mark on his arm and scratch marks on his arms, and he did say that he did tie her up and that he suggested that they throw her into the bayou to get rid of any DNA.
And Pena admitted to kissing her?
Correct. Pena stated that he just kissed her and then helped throw her in the bayou, but that Martinez Rangel did everything else.
That's according to the statement they made to the police, right?
Correct.
Okay.
Good job.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you.